briefly talk about different analysis techniques we can use. So this is by no means exhaustive, but it sort of gives you a flavor of what you can do with PyEMA. So let's get going with this notebook. It's called MSN Analysis 01 Exercise. And there was something that I should tell for Guillermo, is that you should check your email, and there's some installation instructions for the exercise which is coming afterwards. So if you are able to multitask, then you can both listen to what I'm doing and then install more PX at the same time. But otherwise, there will be, you can also wait until we are done.
Yeah, it's just a checking that should be done.
Okay. Okay, so this is not the right window. Okay, I should probably move it up here. Yeah, okay. Good. So let's run through the notebook. I hope everybody has opened it now. We're just doing some basic imports, checking whether we have the right version of PyEMA. And then we are doing some more imports. And then we are defining some functions that will help us later. And then we will load in a Markov state model from files and a clustering object. So we will not spend any time on building Markov state models, we will just assume that we have one available and a cluster syntax available. And then, so the first thing we can do, so that I talked about this morning, and that Fabian also showed you how to use for do coarse graining with the PCCA analysis is to look at the time scales of the model, and for this you do the spectral decomposition or eigenvalue decomposition or eigenvector decomposition. And when you do this, so you can plot the time scales as a function of the process. So on the and maybe I've already done this yesterday, but basically what you have on the y-axis is the time scale with the units, and then you have the index of the process. So here we can see that there are basically two processes, and then you have a gap, and then you have a lot of small eigenvalues. And we can then continue on.
Sorry.
Yes?
Does the first one correspond to the stationary distribution?
No, so the first, because this is all the finite eigenvalue. So
okay.
this is shifted
by one compared to
right. So the first one is not included because otherwise all of the other one would look like zero, because we would have one point at infinity and then we would have a lot of points very close to zero compared to infinity. Okay. So let's move on to plot the so sometimes it's not so easy to discern where this gap is. So we can do this computing the ratio of subsequent timescales to see where there are gaps. So we're basically looking at the time scale at one point, and then at one process relative to the following process. And then we can figure out where, when this value is high, it means that there's a big gap. We can see there's a gap here, and there's a gap here, and then there's a bunch of values that are not so different from one, or relatively close to one, which means that the time scales are approximately the same. This is another way of sort of figuring out whether you have a gap or not. It's a bit of a heuristic, but it still can be useful in some cases. So another thing we can do is to look at the eigenvectors in our clustered space. So we have done clustering prior to this, to constructing this Markov state model, and we have this two-dimensional space, and we can see if we look at the first eigenfunction, you can see that it's changing signs along the first coordinate here, and the first coordinate is this theta coordinate that you looked at yesterday. So we can see that actually the MSN is picking up the same directionality of the slow process as theta does. So there's a consistency between what theta predicts to be slow and what the Markov state model also predicts to be the slowest process. So this is the slowest process, that this is the exchange between these two areas of your configurational space. So of course you don't know what the individual dots are, but these are different conformational states, okay?
Doesn't, like, maybe I get this wrong, but this area seems to be very, like, big. Like yesterday, this, as I remember, we have more confined areas, maybe?
Mm-hmm. And so this is a different molecular system.
Okay, so we can get this kind of thing. So.
Yeah, so this is a general, this is just to show a different molecular system. The reason why we're using this notebook now and not the other one is because you can compute some more interesting observables from this molecular system, but we cannot distribute the data because of copyright issues. So this is why we are distributing a sort of pre-made Markov state model.
Also different plotting functions.
What?
It's just
also different plotting functions that
okay.
We're using.
But the white line is very confusing because it's kind of like half the plot, but it's not halving it at where it changes sign.
Ah,
right?
I see.
Right?
Yes.
So.
No, that's completely true. But that's, I guess that's a feature of Pyama rather than a problem, right? You have to look at the axis.
You must have very, very few negative
values, yeah.
Cluster centers and the interpolation is not even showing.
Yes, no, that's true. This is a good point. So it's important to, of course, look at the scale here when you are inspecting these plots. So the different colors tells you the value of the eigenfunction, and the sort of the gradient tells you the value of the eigenfunction in this cluster center. So basically, it tells you how long along a process you have moved. So this is the same again. So let's try to plot the third eigenfunction. What does it look like? This is then, if we again look at the, at what, so we look at this. This is the second slowest process. And here we can see the negative values down here and there are positive values up here. So this is the exchange of going along the second, more or less along the second the coordinate in our cluster, the space that we have clustered, which is the second tick. So this is again good news for our ticker prediction that we are, that the space that we are clustering in is actually capturing the slow dynamics. And then we can, but again, notice the scales here is that the white line is not the zero point, but it's somewhere above zero, as Guillaume pointed out. We can also look at thermodynamics, so we can also use this scatter contour function to plot the stationary distribution. And here we can see that the probability is high of being in this state, and there's some small probability of being here, and then there's maybe a small cloud over here. But it's very difficult to see because this is in probability, so the probability units, they are normalized to one, so it's very easy to sort of overly suppress transient states when you look at this at the stationary distribution in this way. But you can also plot it as a free energy plot, and it's basically just taking the minus log of the stationary distribution, and then you get a free energy landscape instead. And this you can then you can more clearly see the energetic basin, so the free energy minima here and here, and then there's also a cloud over here. So you can really identify the different states, and then you can get an idea. Then using, for instance, Guillermo's method, you can figure out what this corresponds to structurally and this and this, and then you can get very representative structures and understand what is going on in your simulation. And then, so another thing that we can also do, this is actually something that we should ignore. This is an old exercise that I forgot to remove. So the next thing we can do is compute experimental observables. For instance, if we know that we can measure a distance between two residues, for instance, residue 10 and 34, then I've pre-computed these distances and saved them in this file. So you can load them in, and then we can do a lot of operations on this vector of distances, and then compare and then see what kind of features we can, or what kind of analysis, or how this observable changes as a function of our properties of our Markov state model. So one thing we can look at, for instance, is how does the incredibly stupid. Um, So is it not really possible to send to this speaker? Okay, maybe I can move up like this. Okay. So if you look at this, so this is the distance in the molecular structure, so this is BPTI, between these two residues, and it is, this is the trajectory projected onto the first eigenfunction of the, this is basically, if we look at only the eigenfunction and then evaluate each of our molecular configurations in this thing, then we can see that there are, it's mostly constant and there are some small fluctuations, and then it, all of a sudden it jumps to this state that it visits only once during the simulation, and then it goes back to this ground state again where it's just fluctuating a bit. And if we look at this distance, we can see that it has a very similar profile, so there are some more details of this distance, so a bit more noise. And we can see that it's also exactly changing at the same point. So this is maybe a good reaction coordinate, a good experimental observable to probe this flow dynamic that we have in our molecular system. So we can see that that it's generally fluctuating between around 8 angstrom and 50 angstrom. But we don't know, for instance, what the different how it changes as a function of our cluster space. So this is the next thing we can do, is that we first compute the average distance in each of our cluster centers, and then we can again plot the observable in our cluster space on this observable. Then we can again notice that the scale here is in nanometers, so we can see that the distance is very short over here, and it's very long over here. And this is also, again, correlating qualitatively with the eigenfunction plot that we did before, and with the tick. So this is sort of a very descriptive observable of the slowest process in our system. And then, so for instance, if we then can measure this in an experiment, actually we can measure this distance using an NMR experiment or a small angle X-ray scattering or Fred experiment, then we can, using the Markov state model object, we can compute the experimental value by just using the expectation function of the Markov state model object, and then we get back the average value according to the Markov state model of this observable, which is just in 9 angstrom. And if this then agrees with our experiment, then we are happy. The next thing we can do is compare to these correlation experiments, for instance, from FRET, AMR, or small angle neutron scattering. For FRET, it's easy. You can basically just do compute a correlation function of your observable, which you can do by just calling the correlation function with your observable evaluated in each of your cluster centers. And then you get back the time correlation function of your observable. And this you can then transform into a number of different spectroscopic observables. For instance, in FRET, you can directly compare it to what you measure in the experiments. And then, so another thing you can do if you, because you're not confined to just looking at equilibrium correlations, you can also look at non-equilibrium correlations. So if you can, for instance, prepare your simulation such that you are at elevated temperature or at elevated pH or something like this, so you are away from your equilibrium distribution and you are measuring the relaxation back to the equilibrium. You can also simulate this if you have a good way of representing the excited state or this initial condition. So here we just assume the initial condition is the first of the three PCCA states that we have. This is more or less randomly defined. We just say that we can prepare the molecular system in such a way that we only have one of the three meter stable states, and then we can compute again the relaxation profile, and we can see that compared to this equilibrium thing, we have a much larger amplitude of our signal. So maybe up here, if we just look at the equilibrium correlation function, you can see that it has a very small amplitude. So if you have a substantial experimental noise, probably you will not be able to measure this correlation. Even though you can compute it from your Markov state model, you may not be able to quantitatively compare it to your model. So you will not be able to say whether this is a model compared to just a random line. And but if you then can come, if you can instead prepare your system in this excited state and get a larger signal, then you can more directly compare this. You can be more sure that what you're what you're predicting here is actually going on in the molecular system. Okay, let's move on. So we can also look at this in log scale, and then of course there's something which is not defined.
We just entered in.
So if we look, so we can put it in log scale, and then we can fit a straight line to this with a single exponential fit, and then we can see that there's a one characteristic time scale, vector characteristic time scale with a certain amplitude, which is the dashed line, and then we can convince ourselves that this is a single exponential decay. And yeah, I think this is it from the walkthrough. So this is sort of just to give an idea of different observables you can compute, different types of analysis you can do in the general sense. And then there are a few exercises here that you can take a look at. And you can add new cells beneath by using this plus function here. And then you can sort of think a bit about these problems. Otherwise, we can move on to the next session. So if you want, we can look at this for maybe 15 minutes, and then we can move on to more PX.